We begin with President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s arrival in Washington, D.C. for the historic trilateral summit of the U.S., Japan, and the Philippines. High on the agenda, China's aggressive maritime behavior and deepening economic ties. Our very own Katrina Domingo joins us live from Washington, D.C. with our top story. Kat, go ahead.
Hi, Stanley. A historic and possibly one of the most momentous events in our country's history. That's how Philippine Ambassador to the United States Jose Manuel Romualdez describes the first ever trilateral summit of the Philippines, Japan, and the United States happening here in a few hours. You see, while the three countries are actually expected to amplify their commitment to uphold the rule of law in the South China Sea, Tokyo and Washington are also expected to pour in at least $100 billion in the next 5 years in the Philippines in order for them to accelerate and surge high-quality infrastructure in several key sectors, including energy, maritime cooperation, technology, and cybersecurity. Romualdez says while some U.S. companies are looking to bring in small modular nuclear power plants, the Philippines is also expected to benefit from Japan's growing production of defense and security technologies. Take a listen.
This meeting is not only important, but it is also significant. Aside from the defense strategies that we have put in place, the enhancement of our economic cooperation with Japan and the United States is just as important. The energy exploration, of course, which involves the West Philippine Sea, is also is part and parcel of what we're looking at as to bump up our energy requirements, which should be very which is increasing every year. The more exciting part of the clean energy projects that we're trying to lure into the country is the small modular nuclear power plants. We have 7,640 islands, and this is going to be perfect for us. It's much safer, it's cleaner, and at the same time, it is a very new technology.
Stanley, despite the show of force from Manila, Tokyo, and Washington, Romualdez insists that this activity is not meant to provoke any country. We also spoke to U.S. National Security Communications Advisor John Kirby, and he says that there is no reason for China to overreact to the unilateral strategies happening in the region, specifically the recent quadrilateral exercises involving Australia, Japan, the Philippines, and the United States. Here's what he said earlier.
This is about freedom of navigation. It's about adherence to international law. It's about proving the simple point that we and our allies will fly, sail, and operate wherever international law permits us to do. And it does in the South China Sea, and we did.
Romualdez says all these meetings and deals are rooted on the Philippines' desire to do one thing.
We know clearly what we want to do, which is to protect our territory and our sovereign rights. And so all of these things that we're doing is precisely in that direction. You know, for so many years, the Filipino patience has been stretched to the limit. And we are now at the point where are we just going to sit and allow see our fishermen suffer? We just want to be given our right to be able to explore our own environment, our territory, the respect for international law.
Stanley, all of these commitments as well as projects are expected to be outlined in the joint vision statement that the three leaders are expected to release after the end of their trilateral summit later this afternoon. Aside from these trilateral summit, the president is also expected to hold a bilateral meeting with U.S. President Joe Biden as well as a separate meeting with U.S. Defense Secretary Lloyd Austin. Aside from that, Stanley, the president is also expected to woo several U.S. investors to come and do more business in the Philippines, including several executives from tech companies such as Google. Stanley.
All right, Kat, you know China's not very happy about this meeting. What sense are you getting as to the priority or the prominence of the defense side of the trilateral summit? How big is it? How major is it? that's going to be tackled in the next couple of sessions, because we're also getting a sense that this is an economic gathering, this is to woo investors, this is to improve better cooperations in many other fields aside from defense.
Right. Stanley, John Kirby earlier described this as the first of its kind in terms of scale. He did not specifically give us a specific figure as to the amount of investments that Washington and Tokyo are expected to pour into Manila, but he did say that we will have to wait and see the leader's statement later on for us to get an exact picture of how big or of how heavy the gravity of this trilateral meeting is. Stanley, if we would recall, this is not the first time that the U.S. held a trilateral meeting here. The U.S. earlier held a trilateral meeting with Japan as well as in South Korea, and a lot of analysts are seeing this kind of minilateral strategies as one of the U.S.'s tactics to revitalize its alliances in the Indo-Pacific. Stanley.
All right, Katrina Dumillo, thank you so much for giving us updates. We do hope to hear more from you soon. China asserts there has never been any problem with freedom of navigation in the South China Sea. That statement coming from Chinese Foreign Ministry spokesperson Mao Ning in reaction to the upcoming trilateral summit in Washington.
Thanks to the joint efforts of China and ASEAN, the South China Sea has basically maintained peace and stability. Some countries outside the region, led by the United States, are constantly forming small circles in the South China Sea to engage in confrontation in the name of cooperation, flex their muscles in the name of peace, and create chaos in the name of order.
Beijing claims sovereignty over nearly the entire South China Sea despite competing claims from other countries, including the Philippines.